With the political climate heating up and likely to get hotter, we thought it would be a good idea to get some practical guidelines for employers on how to handle political activity in the workplace. We are fortunate to have Susan Schoenfeld with us today. Susan, an attorney and senior legal editor for BLR's Human Resources and Employment Law publications, is an experienced litigator who has served as an attorney with the Civil Rights Division at the U.S. Department of Labor in Washington, D.C. Susan, welcome to HR Works.
Thanks so much, Steve.
So, what can employers do to restrict or control political activity in their workplaces?
Well, Steve, as you mentioned, and as we're seeing every day on the news and in social media, controlling political activity can be really, really tough. And the good news is that for employers, they have the right to regulate and control employee work time. And as a result, then they can restrict an employee's political activity during that work time by doing things like prohibiting certain activities and behaviors that interfere with their own or another employee's work. Employers can also take steps to protect against the loss of productivity when workers devote time to things that really aren't relevant to a day's work. So if an employee is distracted from his or her duties, it will almost always result in some cost to the company, whether it be indirect or direct. Now, that direct loss of work time and productivity is pretty straightforward, but the indirect harms that I'm talking about are primarily those of reputation. So, for example, an employer can restrict an employee's campaigning on the job if that activity is going to cause the organization to be associated with a certain campaign or a certain political issue. And a case of this might play out where an employee has frequent contact with customers and clients, and that employee will say things about a certain campaign or politician, and those things then, of course, are associated back with the company. And in these cases, employers are permitted to put in place and ask employees to avoid on-the-job politicking.
Ah, that's helpful. Now, what about regulating political activity like, campaign posters or campaign buttons?
That's a great question, and this comes up a lot in the workplace. Now, other than laws that are related to political contributions, there really are no other federal laws that regulate an employee's political activity in the private sector. Now, of course, employees have the right to maintain and express their points of view on political issues, of course, but employers also have that right to regulate and control employee work time. So employers are entitled to prohibit employees from engaging in political activity during work hours. Now, this political season has really shown us very clearly that intense political activity can create a lot of dissension, whether it be in the workplace or at a campaign rally or at any number of places. But in the employment context, problems can really be avoided if employees know that they are not to involve the company in political campaigning, either during or outside of work hours in some circumstances. So for employers that are considering political activity policies, they may include things like prohibiting the use of company materials, equipment, and letterhead to assist in campaigns. They can prohibit using company affiliation to aid in campaigns. They can include a prohibition that literature or soliciting signatures or money occur at the work site, or in some cases even outside the work site if that employee is using company materials or mailing lists. Mailing lists tend to be a rather hot topic because of the power that they may have. Now, of course, there's really no way to stop political discussions, and most employers really wouldn't want to even try to delve into that effort. But business necessity dictates that activities that interfere with work performance can and must be stopped. So a political activity policy should also address things like non-interference with the employee's performance on the job, or, as I mentioned before, the performance of other employees. The policy should also address things like the removal of political material from a workspace and the company's premises if that material disrupts the workplace. And finally, because these issues can sometimes fall into a gray area, the policy should consider containing a provision on referring ambiguous situations to the Human Resources Department. Now, when you're formulating or enforcing that political activity policy, also think about practical things like if you have a non-solicitation policy, it has to be neutrally enforced. So, for example, you can't refuse to let your employees distribute or post flyers at work for one political party and then turn around and allow another employee to do so for another campaign or political party. You might also want to remind your employees of your policy before Election Day or before the primary, if that hasn't already happened in your state, so that the policy is actually fresh in their mind during the time when it is most likely to come into play. Now, if an employer prohibits things like wearing political buttons or posting political posters, the company should be certain that that prohibition is followed not only consistently, but absolutely. Meaning that if anybody, including the company president, wears an election button, that ban actually loses its force. And an employee who's disciplined for violating the policy may actually have a claim for wrongful discipline or discharge, or even in some cases coercion under state law. You can also do things like ban slogan buttons or t-shirts as part of your dress code policy. And this would happen particularly for employees who come into contact with clients or customers outside of the company property.
The Cows, Gus T. Renegade, in for another broadcast, hopefully to share constructive information on the system of white supremacy. I hope no one in our listening audience is wearing MAGA paraphernalia in their work environment, no Black Lives Matter paraphernalia, no Bernie Sanders buttons, anything else. We have talked about that before. Get our guests' thoughts on that for this evening as well. Today's date, Monday, November 2, 2020. So I have been told we will be here tomorrow for the big election, see if we can get through all of this. Like, wow, what a year it has been. Again, now, I think we will be here at 7. Our normal broadcast time is 8 p.m. Eastern, 5 p.m. Pacific, but the election tends to go a little later in the evening. So I think we'll start at around 7, and we'll kind of see what the results are looking like tomorrow evening. But that'll be November 3rd. Tuesday evening, 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, 7 p.m. Pacific. We'll tune in. We will see what happens for the big election. I will say, I said this, you know, this past weekend, I told folks, I would encourage get whatever items you need, resources, supplies, or what have you, so that you can be in your residence. That way, you don't have to worry about if things get a little out of control tomorrow and there's some criminal activity, regardless of who is victorious, you won't be impacted. You can hunker down, keep you and your offspring safe, particularly if it ends up being something drawn out and, you know, it's not conclusive and that sort of thing. Try to get those materials so that you don't have to be out the next few days. If you have to go to work, you can go directly to work, directly back home. Anywho, wow, we normally do Neutralizing Workplace Racism every Friday. We've had the program for years at this point, something we take very seriously here, trying to solve problems in the workplace. What is it? Solving problems without creating new problems in the workplace. We talk about this on a regular basis. That's why I said wearing paraphernalia and t-shirts or buttons or whatever it is, talking about not doing that, and even the whole subject of, you know, make America great again. Who are you voting for tomorrow? Do you even discuss all of that? Super important. We're here every Friday trying to help folks solve problems without creating new problems. Now, our guests for today's program, they've said there have been so many reports just this year because the COVID-19 situation has disrupted everything. It has totally discombobulated the work environment, and so there have been all kinds of reports just about Are we going to work? Are we going to be on Zoom? What do you do if a penis pops up on Zoom? And on and on and on and on. It's just been so many things have been rearranged that it has, you know, caused us to talk a lot about, you know, now what to do in the workplace, if your workplace is at home or Zoom or whatever is happening. The New York Times had a report about people talking about some of the dynamics not being in the workplace and not having that social component of being in the office, being around people, talking, yep, gossip, all the rest of it. And they had one quote specifically. They said, a second powerful deterrent to loneliness is meaningful relationships, and for many adults, the office is a space where real friendships flourish. Our guest for this evening's program, they quoted her, says she spent 30 years researching workplace dynamics and relationships, and she's found that friendships between colleagues are common. I read this. They went on to talk about friendships. We talked about this report on workplace racism a few weeks back, but I thought, hey, it would be great. Get her on the program. We can get some of her thoughts. She's got 30 years of expertise researching workplace dynamics and relating to folks in a work environment. It would be great. Folks can dial in if you have questions. You're in a workspace and trying to figure out the best way to try to resolve an issue. Take advantage. Dial in. See if you can ask our guests some questions. The number is 720-716-7300, the code 564-943-pound. Press star 61 if you would like to participate. Again, our guest, she is an organizational communications specialist and professor at the University of Arizona, Battleground State, as they say. She conducts research on workplace relationships, uncertainty, and leadership. Will be grand. I read a few of her reports talking about some of these dynamics. We are super thankful for her sharing a bit of her Monday evening with us. Joining us live, Dr. Patricia Sias. Dr. Sias, you with us?
Yes, I am. Thank you, guys.
Thanks so much for sharing a bit of your Monday. For folks, I'm sure this might be their first time hearing about you and the work that you do. Any info that you would like to share about your research at the U of A?
Well, I've been, like, as you said, and I feel old, I've been studying workplace relationships and communication for 30 years now. And the reason that I got interested in this from my dissertation, in fact, 30 years ago, was on this topic. And that was because when I was in my doctoral program, you know, I learned a lot about supervisor-subordinate relationships. That was the one that was the most studied. And that was, it's important, obviously, and I do study leadership. But I was stunned by the lack of research on coworker relationships, and in particular, friendships at work. And I think the reason was because everywhere I've worked in my entire career, I've worked, you know, had a lot of different jobs. The people I worked with were what made it or broke it. You know what I'm saying? It can make or break. And, you know, going to work, well, think about it this way. In a typical full-time job, say, you know, minimum 40 hours a week nowadays is a typical full-time job. People who are doing that, they're spending really the bulk of their waking hours at work or with people at work, more than with their friends and family. So if you don't like them, it can be horrible, right? It can be a miserable experience. And if you don't have people that you can kind of trust and count on and talk to, it can be very, very lonely. And so that's kind of what got me. And I've studied a lot of different how and why we would develop friendships with some coworkers and not others, how and why those relationships deteriorate or maybe even end, and a lot of different things around that.
Awesome. That is the way that this year is going. I think a lot of folks say, hey, we will be fortunate to get 30 years to be able to dedicate to something that is constructive. It's been,
yeah,
been a rough
one. Very, very lucky.
Let us see. Super important, since we're audio and folks can't see you and all that good stuff. Or maybe you can go to her webpage. I did link her University of Arizona professor page, so you can go check that out if you want to get a picture. But important question. What racial classification is on your driver's license, birth certificate?
My driver's license. My birth certificate, I don't know what my birth certificate, but I am half Mexican and half white. My mother was first generation Mexican American. My grandparents immigrated from Mexico, and my dad was, I don't know how many generations, his relatives came from Europe. So half, it's a hard thing to answer.
And that was why I asked the question the way that I did. That's important laughter. Because Mexican is not a racial classification. That is a geographic location.
That.
Oh, see, now, see. Listeners, hold on 1 second. Listeners, see, she didn't say, oh, I didn't know that. I didn't know that saying Mexican was not a racial classification. She immediately, no hesitation, said, I know that.
I do know that.
So let me just pause and get back to my question that was not answered. So I asked specifically, what racial classification is on your driver's license, your birth certificate?
It's probably, again, I don't know the birth certificate, but it would probably be, I think the choice now is Hispanic white or white, and then you juice Hispanic is what I typically put on. Answer when I'm asked.
White Hispanic? That's what you generally like for.
Well, they say the race is white, and then you could say non-Hispanic white or Hispanic white is what I typically see now. So when I am faced with that choice, I usually put white Hispanic.
Okay. So for the purposes of this broadcast, Hispanic is not a racial classification either.
Right, but that's what's on the demographic.
For the purposes of this broadcast, I'm laughing now. For the purposes,
when I did 23andMe, and I don't know what to say, it for my mother's whole side, it was this is what it said, and I didn't understand that this was a thing: Native American, and then subcategory Mexico. Which I never heard of. Yeah. So, whatever.
Woo. Man, oh man. Racial classifications are extremely serious for our listeners.
Yeah.
They are extremely serious, and that's, you have to be specific about that in terms of, am I talking to someone who's classified as white? So, just for my own clarification, when I say we're talking to Dr. Patricia Sias, who is classified as white. That's accurate, yes?
Yes.
Man.
Yes.
Woo!
I would say in, yeah, sure you
Man, oh man, oh
but
man.
But in terms of how I identify, it's a little more complicated.
Mm-hmm. Has another white person? Let me, and I do want to get to workplace racism because that's important. We talk about that every week and have done so for years, but this is equally important. So has a white person ever challenged you and said, no, Dr. Sias, Patricia, you are not a white person? Have you ever been challenged by someone who's classified as white?
Oh, well, I don't know if I'd be challenged, but I've had people question me and say, well, what are you? No, really, what are you? You know, where are you from? I'm from California. Well, no, really. Where, you know, that kind of thing that happens a lot.
Has it happened this week?
This week? No.
This month?
I've been in my house.
Okay. Well, let's see. Has it happened this year?
This year. Oh, I'm sure it has, yeah. My students will usually ask.
Okay. Dr. Patricia Sias, white woman. Context of white supremacy. This broadcast, I use the term racism and the term white supremacy as synonyms. Pause right there, too. We are white guests only for a reason. I think we've been on the air 20 minutes. That alone is why we are white guests only. Guests only. White guests only. This program, The Cows, I use the term racism. The term white supremacy, I use them as synonyms. I use the same term, same definition for both terms. The definition is a global system of people who classify themselves as white and are dedicated to abusing and or subjugating everyone in the known universe whom they classify as not white. Do you think such a system exists? Do you think that definition is accurate?
Are you asking me?
Yes, ma'am. Yes, ma'am.
Yes, I do. It exists. I do think it exists.
Okay. Is that, do you think that definition is accurate, the definition I just gave you for racism, white supremacy?
Yeah. I don't see anything inaccurate about it. I mean, that the definition implies intent, right? That I'm actively and intentionally working to subjugate other people. So if people do something that might be perceived as racist, but they don't intend it, that may not be included in that. But yeah, definitely. I agree it exists, and I think that's a good definition.
All right. I guess you said you sometimes people have asked, like, where are you from, that sort of thing. Has anyone, white person or another non-white person, ever accused you or suspected you of practicing racism, white supremacy?
Not to my face. I can't think of a time when that has happened, no.
Okay.
But I'd have to think more about it, maybe. I don't remember, I certainly can't think. I feel like if someone accused me of that, I would remember it because I would have been very upset about it.
Okay. Well, think about it as we go. If you recall one, that would be great if you could
sure. Yeah, yeah.
Share.
Of course.
Recalibrating back to where, for listeners, I would normally ask a white person. I'm recalibrating. I'm going to get back to my greatly pained question. I had to recalibrate for a second. You heard why. So I'll just boom, pick that one up later. So before we get specifically to workplace racism, you are in Arizona, as we shared. I thought that was, I guess I'll just ask, because I thought that was a hot spot for the COVID-19 situation. So I'll just ask, is it, how is your state dealing with COVID-19 at this point?
I think that it's up and down. I think it's starting to go up again, like a lot of places. Different counties have responded differently. So I'm in Pima County, and that in that county and in our city, the mayor has instituted a mask mandate, but there's not a statewide mask mandate. I work for university, and there was a lot of nervousness about bringing, you know, for the semester starting up again, and the university has done a very slow phased approach. But the beginning of the semester, kids came back and they had a lot of parties and things were spiking. And so they had sort of had to tamper that down. But I think if you were to compare us to other states, we're probably pretty good. Not among the best in terms of managing and keeping cases manageable. But our hospitals are not overwhelmed right now.
Have white people been like protesting and saying, you know, we're not going to wear a mask and we're not going to tolerate these lockdowns? Have they had that sort of white defiance in your area?
Not in Tucson. Tucson's a pretty progressive city, actually. It's kind of the blue part of Arizona. So I haven't seen, there's some, but most places you go, people are wearing masks and there's not been a lot of that. I can't speak. There are obviously, it's a, been traditionally a red state, so we might see some of that in other places, but not where I am. I haven't seen much of that.
Okay. And are you teaching, is it all via video and virtual, or are you actually going to the campus?
Everything has been virtual since spring break of last semester. I have gone to campus a couple of times just because there's a computer program on my computer there that I don't have at home that I need occasionally. But
okay,
I don't like teaching virtually.
I've heard that from many folks. Lots of setbacks. Not why a lot of folks got into teaching in the first place, to sit in front of a screen.
Exactly.
All that.
Exactly.
Blame the Rona. Just, I guess, to hop to some of the workplace issues, the election is tomorrow. Talk about relationships in the workplace. There have been reports of brawls and heated arguments and all of that. I have said for years, really, way before we got to this moment in time, very simply, no discussing politics in the workplace. I think that's great. We can talk about, we have lots of workplace things to talk about, dinner and blah, 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 where you go out, family and all that. Politics is one, just very simple sentence. I don't discuss politics in the workplace. What are your thoughts on that? I guess in general, and do they change with what has happened this year leading into this election?
Well, this is going to sound kind of weird, but in some ways, one good thing about the coronavirus is people aren't physically together right now. And so the brawls are going to be less, they're not going to be at the workplace anymore, right? So they're, you know, I wish we didn't have coronavirus. I'm not saying that, but I'm just saying it's kind of removed that face-to-face sort of thing. I agree with you, Gus. I don't think that in general you should be talking about politics at the workplace. I thought that audio clip you played at the beginning was very useful. And I work for a state university, so we have a lot of rules about what we can do and what we can't do at work, and especially as teachers. So, you know, we really are not allowed to talk about politics in the classroom. And, you know, I've had students over the years saying, well, who are you going to vote for? What do you think about this? And I'll tell them, when you graduate, I'll be happy to talk to you about it. But I can't right now. And the reason is because they worry that teachers would have undue influence on students that would be inappropriate. So now, the main thing that I do study in my research is friendships at work. And every place I've worked, I've had really, really close friends. And those close friends, we will talk about politics. Maybe not at work, but at lunch or, you know, on the weekend or something like that. But it's kind of like religion. You need to develop a level of trust and understanding in the other person before I think you should bring up issues, especially in today's current political climate. It's just too hot.
I felt that way even before we got to right now, and kind of the randomness of the work environment. I mean, it's not like you went out and selected all of these folks and carefully vetted everybody, and, you know, we all get, right. I mean, that's not the environment at all, you know, for lots of different reasons. Like, let's just get to what the task at hand is. We have lots to talk about. And even if, let's say, we had perfect views, we both agree, MAGA, all right, you know, 4 more years. All right, we're in total agreement. Even if that's the case, like, us sitting here and chatting for 40 minutes because we've had such a great conversation, that can end up causing problems. Now, then they say, wait a minute, productivity is down because you all are out here running off at the mouth, and that's not what you're paid to do, sit out here and talk about Trump's I mean, lots of different ways. But I just, nope, that is not something that I encourage for a workplace environment. I thought that was interesting. You said in your profession, an educator at a major state university, that you all have lots of rules about what you can talk about and can't discuss who you're going to vote for, unduly influence your students, which I hadn't thought about, but that does make logical sense. Dating, is that?
We can talk to each other about it, but we can't talk to students, right? There's no rule that says I can't talk to my colleague about politics. I don't, you know, but there's not. But definitely there's a lot of rules about what you can talk about with students.
Okay. Dating, what they call, is that in there with students as well? Do you have guidelines about that?
Oh, yeah. You can't do that.
Short and sweet. No dating students. Colleagues, do they have any restrictions on that?
No. The only restriction, and this is typical in most workplaces, is around if one of the partners in the couple is a direct supervisor of the other.
Okay. This is another one.
The power dynamics.
Certainly, which is even more exacerbated if it's a student and a faculty member. They're probably
Exactly.
I have recommended for years as well, no dating in the work environment for about a billion different reasons. I've said if it's that person is that attractive and you all have that much harmony, someone needs to find a new job. That'll make it even better. Do you have any thoughts on dating in the workplace? That's so-called for, or at least the beginnings friendship.
Yeah, I mean, you're right. There's about a billion things that can go wrong. And, you know, if it's, obviously, if it's a supervisor subordinate, absolutely not. If it's coworkers who are at the same level, neither one has authority over the other, it's a little trickier, right? And nowadays, you know, again, people spend so much time at work. It happens. I mean, people, you know, do develop these relationships. And what they need to do, and this is kind of hard, is they need to talk about it with each other and with their supervisor. What tends to happen, research shows, that regardless of whether there is favoritism or what's happening with this couple, the coworkers who observe it tend to think the worst, right? And they'll tend to think that, you know, oh, they're dating, so they're not going to be productive, or they're going to favor each other and all that kind of stuff. Research shows actually that the people in the couple tend to go out of their way to not do that because they're so concerned about these perceptions. So it creates a lot of, assumptions and perceptions that may or may not be right, but whether or not they're right, they have consequences for the relationships among everyone, not just the two people in that relationship. Does that make sense?
Perfect. Crystal clear. Could not say it better myself. I would just echo that again. If the person is that attractive, and certainly, as you said, you spend a lot of time there. Might be that the person is attractive for a lot of different reasons. That's awesome. If the attraction is that great that you really got to pursue this, somebody should find another job as soon as possible. That should be great motivation.
And if it's in a large organization, it could even be another job in that organization, but just separated, you know? Where they don't really work together at all.
Awesome. See? Great suggestion. That's absolutely correct. They will find another location, find another site, all that. That way we're not there. And you can cut down on that gossip because I'm certain it's going to be a totally different dynamic if you are dating someone who is down the hall as opposed to someone who is at the branch that's 15 miles down the road. Like, that might not be gossip worthy at all. Let's see. And I'll get folks, if you all have questions, *61 will bang, get right to your question if you have something workplace racism related. As you said, a lot of folk were, even there have been a lot of white supremacy racism dynamics in who gets to stay home, who has been still going out to work, so-called essential workers. I'm sure you're aware of that, yes?
Yes.
Okay. With, I guess, some folks being able to stay home, not as many non-white people, victims of racism. With the stay-home dynamic, they've said that that has had a lot of different impacts. That was how I found out about your work, the New York Times report, and saying people feeling lonely or alienated because they're not, they don't have the social connections that they typically would being stuck at home, and even, I guess, the Zoom conferences and things, that's not the same impact, per se, hanging out with folks. One, do you have suggestions for people who are at home doing the Zoom conferences, just suggestions so that they don't get too comfortable and make mistakes thinking, oh, I'm at home working just to stay safe. And, oh, yes, this is a work environment type thing. Any suggestions there, number one?
Yeah. Well, I mean, remember that it's work and that you are, if you're on a Zoom call, you are working. So, you know, you don't have to wear a suit, but you don't be wanting your pajamas and that sort of thing. You want to keep personal, you know, items. You know, for example, let's go back to the politics in the workplace. You probably don't want to have all your Biden or Trump signs behind you and wearing, you know, MAGA hat or whatever on a professional workplace Zoom call meeting, just as you wouldn't do it at work. So my advice is, if you are on a Zoom meeting, you're at work, and you shouldn't be doing anything different just because you're home than what you would do if you were at work in the conference room.
Being mindful of those backgrounds, great one. Talk about that. If you can get the virtual background, that's it. So it just shows your face or whatever, like face and upper torso. That can be a great one as well. But definitely you do not want all your, you know, 4 more years paraphernalia and MAGA hats and all that. You do not want that behind you. In the really, I'd say try to have a blank wall. That is great. If you can't do the virtual background, just a blank wall so you're not showing off artwork, anything really, if you can help it, as little as possible. This is not, I think someone had in a New York Times article, like prior to the Rona, if someone had asked, like, would you like to volunteer to have everyone at your job look into your house, most people would have some hesitation before signing up to say yes about that. Like,
yep.
Have a thought or three, regardless, even if you have the most immaculate residents that you'd be proud to show off to Better Homes and Gardens, this is not the time or the place, and it can have adverse consequences, even if it is your residence worthy of Better Homes and Gardens. With sticking with the Zoom calls for a second, I was reading reports like, you know, the New York Times and such, where I found out about your information. That's how I became aware of Jeffrey Toobin. You're aware of Mr. Toobin, New York, the New Yorker, and big best-selling author.
Don't do that.
certainly, he was accused of engaging in sexually incorrect, sexually inappropriate behavior on the Zoom call, and he was suspended. Which is, I mean, just even to be serious for, because I double checked today. I was appalled when I saw it. I said we were live on the air, and I said I needed to take a moment to get my composure back, because I looked back, suspended. They didn't say fired, didn't say terminated. Like, I have been fired for less. I have seen people who were fired for stealing the stapler. You are masturbating on a Zoom call and you are suspended? Are you kidding me? This is one where I pause and say, system of racism, white supremacy. Can you imagine a black male being suspended for that sort of behavior? Not fired?
No, I can't.
System of racism, white supremacy. The sexual component, I am thankful. Even I'll pause for a minute. I was even more appalled. I didn't know that Jeffrey Toobin is like this big time best-selling author. I was confused about that. I hadn't read enough. Reading is more important than watching television. I checked his bio once I saw that he still hasn't been suspended. This fellow wrote a best-selling book on O.J. Simpson. And in fact, it's considered like one of the this is the standard. This is the book that you need to read about the O.J. Simpson trial. In fact, from what I read at Amazon.com, this is the book that the Fox series was based on. It's called The Run of His Life. the hypocrisy. And like, I guess the tone of the book is Mr. Toobin is writing, you know, that no count scoundrel Johnny Cochran played the race card to get, you know, that guilty O.J. off. And, oh, this is a shame and what a disgrace. And then 25 years later, Jeffrey Toobin, with the Zoom, and it seems like there's been a lot of this, people being nude going through the Zoom conference and sexual activity and just all kinds of, do you have any tips in terms of trying to be, because I want to ask about sexual misconduct in the workplace in general, but for this, like anyways, I don't know, I encourage folks to be preemptive, to ask if they have policies about all this, maybe to give a refresher so that people don't get too comfortable, but do you have any tips to try to?
I mean, I'm stunned that anyone would need to be told that you shouldn't be nude on a Zoom meeting call, right? Or that, you know, it's best if you don't masturbate during this thing. I mean, you just, that's just, it's crazy. So I don't know what you shouldn't have to preempt that. But I think that Zoom has tools. So like when we had to switch, we were given a week in March to put all of our classes online. You know, I'd never taught an online class, but I had a week. And I learned the technology, and with Zoom, one of the big problems was what was called Zoom bombing. So people would get in and, you know, put whatever on there. But there are tools that you can use. So, you know, the person who's leading the meeting can control who comes in and who comes out. And they can, you know, even if it got to that, you could just end the meeting and then ask everyone to reconvene, meanwhile talking to the person who committed this act and tell them, you know, if you can't do it, and if you do that again, you're not welcome at the meeting.
Now, I have not had to do any Zoom conferencing as such. I've opted out of that so far, but we've had listeners who've called in for Neutralizing Workplace Racism, educators even, where they've said they've had some of that Zoom bombing where people came in that kept their clothes on, but it was nigger this and all kinds of other vile commentary, and they could not boot the person out of the chat room. And it seemed like their employer didn't think it was that big of a deal. They didn't have an immediate remedy. Was it, since the time that you've used it, it's been easy to, if someone comes in and they're doing that sort of thing, to remove them and, you know, kind of move forward without too much of an interruption?
I haven't actually had to do that. But if I were to do it and I couldn't, I would end the meeting immediately. And then I would send an email to the people who are in the meeting and saying, I'm going to reconvene this in 5 minutes. Come back, and then I would, in that 5 minutes, contact that person. If they were part of the group, if it was a bomber, whatever, you know, I would. You can actually have a waiting room option, so no one can get into the meeting until you know who they are, and then you permit them. So you could do that as well. But that's what I would do. I'd end the meeting, email or contact the people, say, we're reconvening in 5-10 minutes. I'm sorry for what happened. And then if the person was a member of the group, so you're not welcome in this meeting if you're going to do that. If it was a person not in the group, I would use the waiting room option and not let them enter.
For lots of reasons, good idea to maybe be recording your screen during these calls. Hopefully it'll be nothing important and you can delete it immediately, but you never know. Jeffrey Toobin, others, bomber, who knows? I wanted to read this, and we'll check the phone line really quick. I was reading some of your work, an old report, Exclusive or Exclusory, and this is talking about some of the workplace dynamics. And you write, not too far into the report, this type of exclusion can occur with more or less intent. Employees may purposely avoid those who are different from them to avoid discomfort or conflict. Demographic exclusion can also result from a lack of access to similar others, women, and minority employees who obtain positions high in the organizational hierarchy often find themselves as outsiders within a male-dominated environment, making it difficult to form close relationships with colleagues who are demographically dissimilar. This is older, so I'll stop. Anything changed, or is this still mostly accurate, 2020, even though a little time has passed?
Yeah, I think it's still pretty accurate. The dynamics are still in place, I would say. I mean, the thing is, you know, you heard the term glass ceiling and that sort of thing, right? It's one thing to get a job if you're someone who's different. Right, if you're a woman in a male-dominated organization, or you're black in a, you know, white-dominated organization or department, it's one thing to get that job, and that's great, right? But you're getting a job, and you're working in an environment, and that environment may or may not be supportive, and it may or may not be hostile, And so succeeding in that job becomes really, really difficult. And my research shows very consistently that people who have close relationships in the workplace, who have friendships, who have mentoring relationships, they are much better informed. They get information quicker. They get information that other people may not get. They have a real information advantage. And that, of course, means that that helps them perform better than others. And so if you're, let's say that you're a Black woman in a white male-dominated organization and you do get that promotion, because people tend to initially form relationships with people who are like them, you have less options. And so not saying that you can't form friendships and relationships, absolutely people do all the time, but it's not as easy to do. And so you're at danger of becoming an outsider within. You're in danger of being less well-informed than the others. And that, you know, could be a problem.
My conclusion is that is intentional, particularly for Black employees, non-white employees, that you are not going to be well-informed. I think we have lots and lots of people who've called in over the years for our Neutralizing Workplace Racism who described that dynamic exactly. Want listeners, she just said Black woman in a white male dominated work environment. Words are important. One thing that I think is massively inaccurate in the paragraph that I read from your report, exclusive or exclusory, male dominated work environment. We just agreed if Jeffrey Toobin was a Black male, he would be fired. And that would be that, maybe criminally charged, depending on what location, wherever he was. Do Black males, Black male faculty dominate the University of Arizona?
No, of course not.
Had another giggle there. But it was laughable to even suggest that O.J. Simpson and the like have done. That's what I mean. If it's laughable to even suggest, it's ridiculous. And in my view, it might be a deliberate act of white supremacy of racism, because this is so common for people who have lots of expertise to say male dominated. That's not what this is. I'm not even in agreement that it's male dominated. I think it should just say white dominated. That would be most accurate. But I'll play along for a second. If it's going to be male dominated, white, what you just said, white male dominated. That's what it should say every time for the folks who want to say that. I'm sorry, I didn't hear. Did you have a response?
Yeah, I agree.
Okay. So, and this is very common, right? People say it just this way, male-dominated, male-dominated, and that's not what it is at all. It's laughable to suggest that O.J. Simpson is dominating anything. And then the other portion, in my view, that is really inaccurate, and again, for listeners, this could be a deliberate act of white supremacy racism, because this also is very common. They'll say women and minority employees. It suggests that minorities are all male. Or that's another one, they need to do the same thing. It could only mean they're trying to include white women. So if that's the case, this should say white women and minorities, because it would already be assumed that so-called minorities, non-white people, you got males, you got females. I don't think anybody. Oh, again, for listeners, these both are very common, people talking this way. White, now they'll say women and people of color. And I say the same thing. At minimum, if you're going to say that, it would be white women. But in my view, they don't do that, because just saying that, I think a lot of people, I put it that way, I think a whole lot of people would have pause to say, now, wait a minute. Do I think white women's position in the workplace is comparable to non-white people's position? I'll ask you that before we get to our callers. Do you think white women's position in the workplace is comparable to non-white people, particularly Black people's position in the workplace?
No, not 100%. No. I would say that white women's position in the workplace is not comparable to white men. but it's definitely not comparable, you know, perfectly comparable to non-white women.
If we, since we're talking comparisons, do you think white women mm-hmm. are closer in terms of salary, benefits, employment, all of the wonderful qualities one would want in a career? Do you think they're closer to the status of white male workers, closer to the status of non-white workers? And again, some folks, you could just look at the U.S. Department of Labor statistics and that sort of thing for wages. Yeah. And hey, take a gander and already come to a conclusion. But I'm just, what would be your thought? Do you think white women are closer to white men?
I actually have no idea. I have not looked at those statistics, but I'm getting a sense from you that no. But well, I can't speak to that because I don't know those statistics.
Folks can take a gander, and that's another, you have a lot of expertise.
In
30 years, that would be one that, and particularly to make comparisons. That's in your work. People throw that comparison out pretty frequently, and we've talked uh-huh. about it with some of the folks who have looked at. Even we had Dr. Johnson on the broadcast this past summer, and we were talking about wages specifically, that white women make substantially uh-huh. more than black males. Uh-huh. We were talking about that fiction of the uh-huh. male-dominated work environment. Let's see, some of the folks who dialed in, if they have any questions. Let's see. Rob in Wisconsin, did you have a question for Dr. Sias, Dr. Patricia Sias? She should be with us. Rob in Wisconsin. Yes, sir. Oops, not Rob in Wisconsin. Did it again. Rob in California. Get it correct. Rob in California.
Thank you for the accuracy, sir. Greetings to guests, listeners and callers, and thank the guests for being on the program. I guess my first question would be, let me state this. I had a hell of a time, excuse my language, getting on the program this evening. I have 8 call logs from the cows, in my, recent activity from my phone. For some reason, I kept getting disconnected from the line. But to the guests, as I got bumped off of the call, I was not able to get the proper introduction. And I would like to ask the guests, what is your profession and what is your purpose for being on the program this evening?
Okay, hi Rob. I'm a college professor. I teach at the University of Arizona, and I do research in organizational communication and workplace relationships. And Gus invited me on the program to answer anyone's questions about communication in the workplace and workplace dynamics.
Thank you. And I guess my, thank you. I guess my next question would be, thank you. I guess my next question would be, has anything on the program this evening, been humorous? Like, has Gus, like, at all made, like, have you cracked a joke or anything like that?
I don't think we've cracked any jokes. No.
Okay. Gus, I don't have any further questions at this time. Thank you.
Okay. Thank you.
Much obliged, Rob in SoCal. Thank you for being persistent in dialing in 8 times. He said he got disconnected, and I appreciate him sharing, because a number of folks, Gus included, have had difficulty dialing in really for the duration of the time we've been on the program, but particularly about the past 2-3 months, we had a young lady. She said she dialed in 30 times. She said my call log, I think it was even more than 30, where she kept getting cut off and what have you. So it could be interference. If you get frustrated with dialing in, the archive certainly will be available. But it has been a lot of folks who have reported just really strange things happening when they've tried to dial in, being disconnected, not connected, where they, you know, couldn't even get on the line at all. Usual suspects. The caller who dialed in, blocked number. You had a blocked number. Did you have a question for Dr. Patricia Sias?
Yes. Hi, Gus. It's Bea from Toronto. How are you?
Right, poorly. Good to hear from you, ma'am.
Yes. And greetings to your guests as well, callers and listeners. And yes, I do have a question for your guests. I'll start with a quick observation and experience that I've had personally as a Black woman working under the management of white women. The environment that I work in is a white woman-dominated environment within the social services nonprofit sector. And my observations and experience has been that with white women, I've found them to be very arrogant, neurotic. They tend to get away with a lot of incompetence. They get promotions based on mediocrity. They block promotions. They get away with sexual harassment and abuse and or abuse, as well as getting away with a lot of white supremacy and racism. I've experienced it. I've seen it. I've encountered other non-white gentlemen who have experienced it as well. And I also noticed at the same time, while they are the perpetrators of all this, most of them, not all, they tend to be the most protected group within the workplace. Maybe it's because of the friendships that are being formed or unjust networking. So my question is, why are white women the most to benefit from affirmative action? And knowing the information that I've provided, should white women still be a beneficiary of affirmative action because they're getting the benefits of white supremacy and the benefits of affirmative action? Isn't that rather greedy? Thank you, and I leave the line.
Sure. Thanks, Bea. Well, I'm sorry that you have to work in an environment like that. That sounds horrible. And you're working in, you know, nonprofit social services, so that work is really important, and you shouldn't have to deal with this stuff on the side. With respect to affirmative action, I'm not sure, I'm assuming you're not talking about the legal definition of affirmative action, which is basically making efforts in the hiring process to generate a diverse pool of candidates. I think what you're saying is that it's more of a culture and climate kind of issue, that you are working in an environment where the climate benefits white people and disadvantages those who are not white. And in this case, apparently white women, because they seem to be the ones who are in charge of that. I think you're really smart to suggest that one of the reasons that they're getting away with it is the friendships and the relationships they have with each other. So it sounds like there they have formed a pretty strong, and to go back to that chapter that Gus was talking about, a very exclusive network that involves them, and they protect each other and, support each other in abusing and mistreating the other employees. So if it is an organization that is dominated by white women, and these types of white women in particular, it would be particularly difficult to address. I don't know if there's any official outlet like Human Resource Department that you could go to. What I teach my students in every class is the importance of documenting incidents of mistreatment. And it doesn't have to be necessarily documented with HR every time, but keep a record of every time that you notice or you see or it happens to you. And then when you develop, you know, you have these sort of, with dates and times and as verbatim of a conversation as you can have, that really helps if you're going to go to human resources to complain. Now, if the human resource department is part of this exclusive group of white women, then that's probably not going to get you very far. In that situation, the best bet is forming relationships and coalitions and allies with other people who can support you and who can support each other and maybe together disrupt the system. Okay. I hope that answers your question.
Unfortunately, it doesn't.
Okay.
The reason being there's been a number of organizations that I've worked for. It's been consistent that it's mainly white women that are taking on managerial positions. Oftentimes, one would think that it's human resources that are involved in the hiring practices, but it's actually white women managers who are involved in the hiring, and human resources just helps the process along in ensuring that the candidate gets into the position. The other factor that is also needed to be taken into consideration is that because oftentimes human resources is a white woman, there is it's most likely that non-white people are much less to be hired. So it's very hard to make any coalitions or alliances, as you suggest. It's pretty much like a cartel. Of white women that within this particular industry, I'm not quite sure how they are in other industries, but in this particular industry, it's pretty much a cartel of white women that are dominating who gets into what position. It just really rebukes the whole white male dominancy type of deal when white females are the dominant ones in this field and are causing the same type of disruption, if not more, because they feel they can get away with it. In addition to that, white women, because they are considered as women, are under an identified protected group, which is also makes it hard to go against bringing up harassment charges against them. Again, they're very protected, as you would know.
Yes. Yeah. No, I see what you're saying, and that's incredibly frustrating. The thing about, so the company can feel good about placing a woman in a managerial role if it's a white woman, right? They check that box, and then they don't pay attention to what's happening to everybody else. I don't have obviously there's not an easy answer to it, or, you know, you're pretty smart, you would have figured that out, right? The only thing I could say is, again, document, try to keep evidence. And just for your own sanity and emotional health, having allies. Maybe you're not going to have them in your particular organization, but there are professional organizations and things like that where you can talk to people, get advice. Coming to shows like this and other things can help. But that cabal has to be broken, just like the white male cabal has to be broken. And so, the glass ceiling is only open to a very few type of people, type of women.
That answer your question, V?
No, it unfortunately it doesn't satisfy it, but it is what it is. Thank you very much.
I'm sorry.
Context of
a hard one.
White supremacy.
Mm-hmm.
Before we'll get Mo in Dallas, this is an easy one. I'll get one of the questions off my list. Dr. Sias, do you have any black friends who are your colleagues at the University of Arizona?
At the University of Arizona, no. I have colleagues, black colleagues in my field, but not at the University of Arizona. Hmm.
Not a black male dominated institution. We already got that.
No, not at all.
Mo from Dallas, if you have commentary, you should be with us.
Thank you, guys. Greeting to the listeners and callers, and thank you to the guest. I had a question. When I was dialing into the program, I kind of missed at the beginning when she gave her racial classification. Does she identify as a white woman?
I identify as a, I'm going to talk about identity and not race, right? Half Mexican, half white. No, Mexican's not a race. That's what I'm talking identity, ethnic identity, I guess.
Okay. Have you ever introduced yourself as a white woman? Or do people assume you're a white woman?
I never introduced myself as a white woman, no. I assume, I don't know what people have assumed of me. I'm 60 years old, so I'm assumed a lot of things I would say.
I can understand that. Do you know of any profession completely dominated and controlled by black males?
No, I do not.
Okay.
Is there? Do you?
How can I, how can black males protect themselves from white women in work environments? If you could give me three tips on how I could go about protecting myself, or all
black men. Protect yourself in terms from what?
Speaking from personal experience, I've been, let's say, sexually harassed. There are comments made about, you know, my clothes and I've been harassed for not harassing people, believe it or not, or not engaging in banter at work and things of that nature. I kind of try to stay to myself because I didn't want to be targeted, and that's kind of, it kind of made me a target, you understand? So if I were to if you had three tips on how, I guess, me as a black male or any black male could not be what anything that we can do so that we're not targeted at work, what would you recommend? That's all I have for now. Anybody?
Well, sure. In terms of like sexual harassment and that sort of thing, and this is what I tell my students anyway, is don't be alone with someone that you don't trust. So, or with someone who might make accusations or inappropriate, if you can, right? If you can avoid it, don't be alone. Don't shut your door. If you're meeting with them in an office, you know, keep it cracked or something like that. That's one piece of advice. So that if something were to happen, there are witnesses. First of all, if you do that, it's less likely to happen. And if it does happen, there are witnesses who can back you up. And then you would want to certainly document if you feel harassed, if you are harassed, if you feel you're being mistreated. You know, I can't stress enough the fact of writing it down, keeping a record, so that if it becomes a pattern of harassment, sexual harassment, legally, to take action, there has to be a pattern to it. Right, and you can't show a pattern if you haven't documented a series of incidents. So, you know, don't be alone, keep the doors open, and document are my best advice of my three things that I can think of right now. And tell people about it. If it happens and you've got friends at work, which is another really good reason to have friends, or it doesn't have to be friends at work, but tell, you know, your spouse or a non-work friend, but tell people what happened. So again, that there's a record.
document. Talk about that often. Much obliged, Mo in Dallas. Let's see. Retired firefighter in Florida. If you had a question, you should be with us.
Greetings, Gus. Greetings to the guests. Greetings to all the callers. To the guests, with your 30-some-odd years of expertise, my question is, do you think, and this as this is question is based on providing of solving the problem of racism in the workplace, do you think that non-white black people who, in order to remedy or solve their problem through promotional advancement, do you think that would solve the problem of racism in the workplace if black people would just take promotional exams or make plans to advance promotionally? Would that solve the problem of racism? If so, why? If not, why?
I don't think it would solve the problem of racism, because making plans to advance doesn't mean that you will advance, right? And you may not advance because of racism. So that's one thing. However, if you do make those plans and you do those promotional things that will help you move up and get promoted and are promoted, that helps, absolutely. Doesn't solve it, right? But it can certainly help. And as more and more, so again, going back to sort of that ceiling effect, right? As more black employees are represented throughout the organization at all levels and in all kinds of departments, right? That is what it will take to begin to solve the problem. And if that helps.
Hold on, repeat that last thing, because it sounds like you were talking in the hallway.
Oh, I'm sorry. What I was saying, can you hear me now?
Repeat the thing that you suggesting that would work. That was the last thing I think you were saying.
Sure, can you hear me now? Is it better?
I can hear you now.
Okay.
That's a little bit better.
I was saying that to really begin to solve the problem would require that non-white employees, men or women, right, are represented at not just all levels of the organization, but in all kinds of departments. So, you know, the engineering department as well as the manufacturing department. And once you get, so that then they have allies and they have a community that they can reach out to for mentoring and support and that sort of thing. Once that becomes the case, that will go a long way towards, I don't know how you can actually solve the problem of racism in the workplace, but it would help a lot. But to go back to B's question, how so would it help?
Yeah, how so would it help?
Well, because then those people would be in positions of power. And they would be in positions where they...
I'm sorry, say that again.
That if people are promoted, let's just stick with black men for this person especially, are promoted, right? Then they are in positions of authority where people cannot... They have less ability to control them and that sort of thing. Again, not solving the problem of racism, but helping. But to go, I want to refer back to what Bea was talking about a couple of conversations ago, right? Just because white women, you know, women are now in positions of authority, right? It doesn't mean that it solved the problem of women's issues in the workplace if they're being racist, for example, and exclusive.
Okay.
So white women are not effective, is what you were stating.
I'm not saying they're not effective. I was saying in the particular organization that B was talking about in an earlier conversation, she was saying that the white women who are in positions of authority in her and her industry, in fact, are racist and mistreating and abusive to non-white people. Is what I was saying.
Right. I heard that part. Yes. Yes.
Mm-hmm. Yes.
I heard that.
Which I guess means ineffective. Yeah. So what I'm saying, I didn't get your name. I know that you're a retired firefighter in Florida. What I was saying is that...
Literally.
Yeah. What I was saying is that to begin to really seriously address the issue of racism in the workplace, you need diversity represented in positions of authority in different functional areas of the organization. And until that happens, it will be very difficult.
Okay.
Did you have another question, retired firefighter? That's it?
That's it. Thank you.
Much obliged.
Okay, thank you.
Context of White Supremacy, number again, 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. My question from before, now that I have it, there's a non-white author. He wrote a report on racism some time back. He has a sentence. He was talking about white people. He writes, "White people are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism, but rarely are they pained enough." And I've asked our white guests on the program, just your time on the planet, your research, white family members, friends, colleagues, staff, that sort of thing. In your personal opinion, do you think that a substantial number of individuals classified as white are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism? Do you think that's true?
Oh, for sure. I mean, some are, not all of them, right? But definitely there are some, and I know many of them, and I am one of them. But whether we do enough and, you know, pained enough is another question. See, one of the things that happens in the world of work, and it's in our personal life as well, is that we're very, very busy people, right? If you're working, you've got a family, you've got your personal life, and so it can become easy to just focus on what you need to do to get through each moment, right? And to sort of do what you need to do in your job. And having that time to sit back and reflect and think about bigger issues in the workplace, like racism, sexism, whatever that is, while you might be paying for it, you may feel you don't have time. Or you may be so focused on getting through that next meeting, getting through that next presentation, whatever it is, that the day is over. So I think that there are people, I know there are people, who are sincerely pained by racism. But clearly, by the fact that it still exists and it's still, you know, incredibly painful for those who experience it, not doing enough about it.
Here's
how
the thing,
is it?
Just fucking good luck at the work.
Makes your work lean.
You're just saying just buckets and buckets of work.
You said you, as a white woman, are one of the folks who is sincerely, greatly pained by racism. How do you, Dr. Sias, demonstrate that you are often sincerely and greatly pained by racism? Are there any anything that you can point to say this is evidence of my great pain about racism?
I'm doing the show. It's one thing. I talk about it in my classes. I try to teach my students about the causes of or the effects and the forms of racism in the workplace, and I try to help. I have training classes where I do that.
Training classes. Wow. What can you tell me about your training classes? What do those classes?
Yeah, I train my students how to become trainers. And one of the things that we do is we do modules on diversity, on racism, on harassment, and on microaggressions. And how to, not just what they are, but how to deal with particular situations as they come up.
Give us an example that you would use in one of your trainings of a microaggression.
Oh, a microaggression. Well, I can do one that I experienced. It's not racial. It's more of a sexual or a
we asked
thing.
You're greatly pained
racism.
About racism.
Okay, by racism.
You can give us this one, but I'm just pointing that out for listeners. This was you're greatly pained about racism.
At one organization that I worked at many years ago, I was referred to as the little brown one. And it was descriptive. I am little brown, but... that would be one example, right? And so when a friend of mine heard people saying that, she said something to them about it, that she's more than just little and brown. That would be an example of a microaggression.
Training. So again, this was all stemming from the question, are white people sincerely and greatly pained by racism? You said yes. Not pained enough.
I said some are.
Some are. Some are.
Yeah, and some are pained enough, I would say.
And you included yourself in that number, some, and evidence of your great pain about sincere and great pain about racism, white supremacy, and what you do because of that sincere and great pain is being on this program, teaching your students, doing trainings. Just this would be another point where I would highlight the laughter in the broadcast tonight as one. And this was not even pitched as Dr. Sias, come talk to us about racism. This was pitched as come talk to us about workplace issues. I can go back and even read the email. And then I'm just going back and looking over. This is at the University of Arizona, your page. It says doctoral degree, organizational communication with a cognate area in management, University of Texas, Austin. We've had a number of folks on the program from down there. Organizational communications, workplace relationships, uncertainty in leadership, articles and communications, monographs, human communication research, management communication quarterly, journal of social and personal relationships. Blah, 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 blah. Okay, goes through some of the publications that you've authored, Lost in Translation, Employee and Company Constructions, Workplace Relationships, Exclusive or Exclusory. I don't see the word racism mentioned anywhere on your faculty page, and I read quite a bit just to show listeners.
Right.
It's not like this is, wait, hang on a second. Hang on. Let me finish. Hang on a second. I'm going to let you respond for sure. But just, I read quite a bit to show it's not like this is Twitter. Like we got 50 characters, you know, got to be brief. Like it's quite a bit here. I don't see anything about racism. Now, I read some of the reports where you bring up, what was it? Microaggressions. Discrimination. And I see some of that, but I mean, that's not really getting to the crux of the problem. We agree there's a system of white supremacy racism. So for you to say that you are greatly pained by racism, and your evidence is your trainings, what you teach your students, and you being here on this program.
Hang on, you didn't let me finish.
You're interrupting. In fact, that could be practicing racism right now, because I just said I'm going to let you respond. We haven't been interrupting you. The things that you shared in terms of how you're greatly pained, what you do to demonstrate that, that is also laughable. Being on this program does not qualify as that much. And again, this wasn't pitched as coming to talk about racism. This was just coming to talk about workplace issues. Two, like your trainings and what's on your faculty page, I don't see the word white supremacy. I don't see the word racism. Why would I think that what you're doing in the classroom or your trainings, in fact, the example that you gave us wasn't even about racism. You were going to sexism until I stepped in to say something. So why would I, following logic, believe, yes, this is one of the minority white people who is allegedly sincerely often and greatly pained by racism? Why would I, following logic, conclude that?
I don't know what you want me to say. I feel like you're attacking me at this point. I said that I am pained, and I said that I don't do enough. It is not my area of expertise. I haven't been trained. My program of research is what it is. That doesn't mean that I don't care about racism, and I don't want to see it addressed.
Hmm. You said that you feel like you're being attacked. What does that mean exactly?
Well, you're accusing me of being something that I'm not, of coming to this show thinking it was something that I'm not, and of not doing enough about racism.
Which are you?
Yes, that's probably true.
Oh, okay.
No, I said from the beginning.
Okay. I don't recall saying that you didn't. Did I accuse you of anything? I just want to be clear. Did I say at any point that you're not doing anything about racism?
Yes. You went through my entire record and said I don't do anything about it, and that it was laughable what I said that I did do.
Okay. And you did agree you don't do enough about racism. So at minimum, if I did accuse you, it would be an accurate charge. Yes.
Okay. Yes, sure. Okay. Yes, absolutely.
And I don't have a gun next to, she said attack. Like, I don't have a gun.
Oh, my gosh.
She's in air. Oh, my God. Now, we don't have a, you were laughing before. Wait a minute. What happened? We were laughing and joking before. You were having a grand old time, and now it's sighing and oh my God, and what is the problem now? I'm just trying to evaluate. We were in agreement. There's a system of white supremacy. We were in agreement. You are a white woman, even though that did take some effort, and we're in agreement that you don't do enough to try to solve this problem. So what is the issue?
There is no issue.
Continuing. Who do you think is more confused about white supremacy racism? Individuals classified as white, individuals classified as not white.
Individuals classified as white.
Hmm. Why do you say that? The people classified as white are more confused.
Because they don't experience it.
They don't experience
the racism the way that non-white people do.
Hmm. Do you feel like you are not informed about racism? You feel like you're poorly informed about racism, what it is, how it works?
I don't know if I'd say poor. I'm not as well informed as you, because this is what you do and your experience, certainly. I don't think it's an either or. You either are or you aren't. It's more or less. I'm on the left side, which is why my research is not in that area.
Okay. I'll ponder on that one for a moment. If other student or other listener, or I guess your students too, other students that are listening in, if you all have questions, the number is 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. Have you heard of Allison Manswell? She's a black female. She does similar work in terms of workplace dynamics and such. She's been on like mainstream outlets, NPR, talking about workplace dynamics. She has a book titled Listen In that's about workplace dynamics. Are you familiar with her work, Allison Manswell?
No. Do you know what university she's at?
I think she just works privately. I'm not sure if she's affiliated with the university per se, but I have to double check. She has a website.
I'm not familiar.
Okay. Her, she has a book, as I said, it's titled Listen In, Crucial Conversations on Race in the Workplace. And she was a guest on our program right before the election in 2016, no less. And she had a really interesting point. She was talking about, obviously, workplace issues, but we talked about specifically sexual harassment. And she gave great recommendations on how to avoid sexual abuse. She said some of the same things you did about avoid being alone and all that good stuff. She said she would tell black females, non-white females, she does trainings and things. She would tell them, you know, speak up, be assertive, be confident so that people can hear you and hear that, oh, okay, she's competent, knows what she's talking about and, you know, ready to speak up and be a leader at this company. Great. She says she does not share that with black males. In fact, she said she tells them the opposite, that if you speak too loud, if you're, you know, trying to be assertive, that you might be accused of attacking a white person. And I said, really? And she said, yes, I have to give them totally different advice in terms of where they stand. If they're taller, she said, like if they're 6'2" or something like that, where you'd be thought of as a taller person, like, whoa, be careful. You don't want to kind of be standing up where it appears that you're kind of intimidating a white person, white male or female, if you're there. What do you think about her suggestions? And do you give out any of those type of suggestions specifically for victims of racism in your trainings?
I think she has a point. I think it's all, your context of white supremacy, right? So within context, there are contexts. And so depending on the culture and the climate of the organization, that might have an impact. But as a general type of advice, I could see her point.
Hmm. When you do trainings, do you have any specific tips or strategies for victims of racism that this is something that I might tell white people, but I'm not sure. Maybe you should think twice about this or vice versa?
I don't recall doing that. I can't think specifically. In general, I don't recall doing that, no.
Okay. We've had tons of white people on the program over the years. One of our favorite questions asking white people if you can recall any racist jokes that may have been shared with you, if you can remember, if you could share, that is something that we appreciate studying. So the question, have they ever told any racist jokes to you? And if you can remember one, if you could share.
I can't remember that happening. I certainly can't remember one specifically. No, I mean, I work in academia and I work in my discipline. That's not that common to happen, I would say. So no, I can't recall that.
So it's never happened? Someone classified as white has never told a racist joke to you? Or just you can't remember one?
In any context. Oh, yeah, obviously. In my life, I'm sure I've heard something like that, but I can't remember one, no. It's not common. And certainly I can't imagine that happening with the people I've worked with.
Okay. I don't know. I haven't been to, I have been to Arizona. I haven't been to the University of Arizona, but I have been to Arizona. I don't know. Are you concerned? I know President Trump, he just did the legislation about restricting the types of training, anti-racism trainings within federal programs, uh-huh, and saying that it's anti-white and causes all these problems. Are you concerned that that might impact any of your trainings?
Well, I'm concerned about it generally. I don't think it would impact my trainings because I do line in it. It's part of my class. I'm teaching the students how to become trainers. So, no, I would still keep teaching it.
Okay. Do you, like you said, you do you're training your students to become trainers. Do you do any actual training of like working with like businesses or companies or just, you know?
Mm-hmm. I have.
Okay.
I have done that, yeah.
Okay. Okay. Is that where you do the work like you were talking about with so-called microaggressions and, you know, telling them this is what to do if someone comes and says that you're a little brown girl, that type of thing?
Yeah. I haven't done, in terms of my actual work, I've trained in organizations, it's been more generally workplace relationships and that sort of thing. The microaggressions is what I've been teaching in my classes to the students.
I see. Okay. Okay. And what are the demographics of your students at U of A, like in terms of the folks who typically would be taking your classes?
Probably 60% women, 40% men, and then within that, I would say probably guessing 20% Hispanic, maybe just 1-2% black, and the rest would be white.
Wow. Okay. You said 20%.
Hispanic.
Hispanic.
At least.
At least. Yeah. Okay. Okay. So that's like. Mm-hmm. Wow, like 75% white?
Hispanic, yeah. Oh, yeah. And it's not a much black population at the University of Arizona.
Oh, okay, okay. Fascinating. Let's see. The number again, about 15 minutes or so left, 720-716-7300. The code 564-943-pound. Press *61 if you would like to participate. We've had tons of. Oh, I'm not gonna forget that. I'll get to that one later. I can't believe
it. Can I be heard again, Jeff?
Yes, sir. I'll get you, retired firefighter. Do you have any tips with regards to the COVID-19 situation? Because that's another one. We've had tons of folks who called in where they have coworkers who are not taking this seriously with many aspects of it. They're either not distancing, they're not wearing a mask, they're touching or bringing food in, like lots of different things that would not distancing, not taking this seriously. Do you have any tips or suggestions for folks to try to stay healthy, what they can do if they're working with folks who just aren't taking it serious?
Right. If you have the opportunity to distance yourself from the people who, you know who these people are, right? If you can work in a different location and avoid them, that's probably the main protective thing that you could do. You could talk to them, but, you know, that could end up in a really tricky situation. We've seen the videos of people, right, who get into these shouting matches about it. You know, wear your mask. You can control what you do. Right. So wear your mask, socially distance as much as you can. And if you can't, then I would talk to supervisor or human resources or whoever is responsible for enforcing, assuming your company has a rule or a policy.
For sure. Snitch. I've said that one quite a bit. Snitch. If you have to even go outside the agency, if they have a health department in your area, that sort of thing. Some folks have reported some success with that. Kind of some public shaming type thing. We're getting a more powerful white person to kind of come in and finger shake. Retired firefighter. Did you have a question, sir?
Yes, sir. It first starts off with a observation. To the guests, you sounded very much like a white female coworker that I worked with about, I guess by now it was probably about 20 years ago, 15, 20 years ago, who reported to the fire department that about. She accused myself and several other black males of some sort of, I don't know exactly how she explained it, but it was something along the terms of intimidation or something like that. She accused us of something, and I think I heard you accuse Gus of something also. And in turn, what it ended up as a reaction to her complaint was they sent the highest level employees on the fire department to the station to talk to us non-white black male niggers on the subject and attempted to make us to write memos, which we refused to do so. We weren't breaking any rules or anything. We were just having a conversation amongst ourselves. Wasn't even talking to her. So my question is, do you think that she was, because you answered, I'm focusing on how you answered his question. Do you think that she was unaware of the turmoil that she created?
I have no idea.
And my second question is, could you define for us on what an ally is? But go ahead, ma'am. I'm sorry for interrupting. Go ahead.
Sure. I can't speak to the situation you talked about. I couldn't tell you what she's aware of or what happened. So I don't know how to answer that question to you. That people got brought in indicates to me that she might have reported it to someone, which would indicate she was aware of something. But I really don't know. I don't have enough information. An ally. Allies are, definition is people who may not be in a member of your community, but who support. So, allies of black or gay or whatever that is, they're people who are there to support, to help, to sort of fight the fight with you, but without being a member of that community.
To what extent do you suggest a white person should render assistance to a non-white person when they are being mistreated based on color? To what extent?
I think to as much extent as they can, with whatever power and ability they have, they should.
Let's say even if their life is in danger?
Well, then they may not feel that they can go that far. I don't know. Again, that would be, I don't know.
Well, it could be necessary, wouldn't it? It could be necessary in some cases. Is that correct?
I would assume so. There would be cases in that situation, okay. Yes. Especially if you think about firefighting.
I figured you would say, anyway, you would say whatever the answer is. Okay. That's it. Thank you. I don't want to overtalk myself.
Much obliged. Was that Mo in Dallas?
Yes, sir.
Yes, sir.
She explained that she experienced a microaggression, being called a little brown girl. I would like to know, because I think I wouldn't like to speak for other victims of racism, but I know, being subject to racist acts at the workplace is a very traumatizing event, and it kind of ingrains in a lot of victim psyches, and it has an impact on their work performance and whatnot. I would like to know if she could give us an example of a overt act of racism that she's experienced, if that's possible.
Mm-hmm. I'm not sure even how overt. I cannot think of one off the top of my head now.
I can give you an example. I have personally been called, a nigger.
Mm-hmm.
I've been threatened to be assaulted. I've had my, you know, workstation manipulated. I've had things taken. Mm-hmm. I think someone is at my current job keeps messing with my car mirror. Examples that on the outside, specifically my passenger mirror. So if you could have any examples like that.
No, I don't have any examples like that. And that has not happened to me. I'm sorry that's happened to you.
Well, thank you.
Thank you.
Much obliged, Mo and Dallas. Did any of the other folks that are with us, did they have a question that they want to ask? Grant, soon folks. Oh, they did. Robin, SoCal.
Very quickly, and just piggybacking off the vocabulary that the last caller used, he said that he was under the threat of assault, right? And I heard the guest use the word attack and said that Gus was attacking her, you know. And on this program, you know, to us, words are very important. And I would like the guest to answer for me, why would she use the word attack, saying that Gus was attacking her when he was merely disagreeing with her? And under, I'll leave it right there. Thank you.
Sure. I shouldn't have used that word. I'm sorry. It was an inappropriate word and incorrect, and I didn't think about the context in which I was using it. So I apologize.
I just wanted to make sure I included for the record.
Can I ask one more question?
Yes, sir. I just wanted to include for the record, we didn't, or excuse, I say it without the double negative, we had agreement. She said that I accused her of not doing enough about racism, which is true. So there was no false charge. There was no disagreement.
I agree. There was no false charge. I think it was when you were just going through my record, and I felt that you were not attacking me, but that the fact that I don't study racism in the workplace was a problem. And I never claimed that I studied racism in the workplace. So that was my perception. I felt that way. And I should not have used the term attack, and I apologize for that.
Rob in Wisconsin.
One more question. I am still a little confused as to the racial classification of the guest. Now, I want to say, I heard her say she identifies as a white and Mexican female. And then I also heard her say that she was referred to as a little brown person or a little brown female. And my question to the guest as far as racial classification is concerned, are you classified as a Hispanic white person?
Yes.
Did you get disconnected, Rob? Did we lose
you?
No, she I asked the question, and she answered it. Thank you.
Oh, okay.
Right on. Thank you.
Right on. Did we get everybody? Everybody who had a question? We didn't miss anyone?
Hi, Gus.
Be in Toronto.
Yes. I just had one question that was not answered, and I'll reiterate that question. Granted that white women are the beneficiaries of white supremacy as well as affirmative action, would it be correct to say that white women should no longer be beneficiaries of affirmative action. And that, in fact, Black men need to be more of beneficiaries of affirmative action on the account that white women are making more than Black men. Black men are more unemployed. White women have more power just on the fact that they are white and female, more so than Black men. So would it be correct to say, of which I would already believe that it would be, that white women should be removed as beneficiaries of affirmative action based on the fact that they're beneficiaries of white supremacy?
Yes, but I would also say you would have to look at context, because there's probably some industries and contexts where women are not in any position of power, whether they're white or Black, and so in that case, maybe not. But yes, in general, I would agree with you, yes.
Yes, and just to clarify, I'm not speaking about women in general. I'm speaking specifically to white women, because when the discussion is about women, it's often referred to white women. And oftentimes when I work with white women, then my gender is eliminated and I'm just referred to as Black by white women.
Yeah. Yes.
Thank you.
I understand that. Yes, I agree with you.
Fascinating. Much obliged to be in Toronto. Dr. Sias, do you know who has benefited the most from affirmative action, as it's called in the U.S.?
Probably women, white women.
No, probably, by far, white women. Yes, yeah. You, and white and women classified as white, like you, have been by far the greatest beneficiaries, like not even close. System of white supremacy. Before your exit, I did also think it was important, because I was reading your work and you have lots of details about, hey, those workplace friendships and relationships are important. People who report having higher quality relationships at work get better information. They get that information sooner, whether it tends to be rumors, or there could be a merger, or we're getting new masks and hand sanitizer, whatever it is. It just tends to be, things tend to be better if you have better quality relationships in your work environment, which is, you know, logical, common sense. But the overwhelming evidence suggests, and in fact, that's in Isabel Wilkerson's case that we're reading, white people collectively do not want to be friends with Black people. If that is the case, that would present a massive obstacle in the workplace. I guess one, do you think, just following logic and the evidence, is that accurate? White people, it seems, collectively.
Absolutely. Okay. Yeah, I mean, people, yes, they're, in terms of friendship development at workplace, people tend to become friends with people who are demographically similar to them. And so it's kind of what I was saying before, as you move up the corporate ladder, you know, if you're Black, there are going to be fewer and fewer people like you, which means it's going to be more difficult to form those kinds of friendships.
I do want to pause for a second, because we're not saying the same thing. She started her response saying people form friends with folks who are demographically alike, demographically similar. That to me is suggesting that this is a problem of just there aren't other Black people at this level. That's not what I'm saying it is at all. The reason that there are no other Black people is because white people don't want to be friends with Black people. White people don't want to hire and or promote Black people. White people practice racism, white supremacy. That is substantially different from people form friends with us. That's what Dr. Sias, you can write this one down. Today, November 2, 2020, you were accused of deliberately, willfully practicing racism, white supremacy. So if you ever get asked that question again, oh yeah, that one crazy time, that guy on the podcast, he did say, yes, Dr. Sias, I think you're deliberately practicing racism, because you know this is not just they're dissimilar. In fact, have you studied any work environments where it's mostly non-white people in the work environment, but there were some white people, but it was a mostly non white work environment? Have you studied any scenarios like that?
No.
I have worked in scenarios like that where there was a like lone white minority and they did not struggle to have friends, to move up the ladder. That was not a problem for them at all, which is what, in fact, they had a big article all the way on the other side of the world. They would pay white people who were unqualified, incompetent, don't know nothing, can barely add 2 plus 2. They would pay them to just come sit at a desk so it looks like they are important and they work there. This was in like China or some foreign country where it's mostly non-white, but someone classified as white could get this job. That is, and it didn't say these folks are bullied and mistreated and, you know, they can't get any friends. It was, wow, this is amazing. Just being classified as white, I got a great job. I don't have to do anything but sit here and be white. I have to get that article because that was like 10 years ago. I have to. Do you remember the report that I'm talking about? Do you, you know what I'm talking about, Dr. Sias?
I don't. I do not know. No.
I will pull it up.
About. I don't know that report.
I will pull it up as you exit. University of Arizona Wildcats, College of Social and Behavioral Sciences, expert on workplace racism, 3 decades of experience studying the material that we talked about this evening. Dr. Patricia Sias, it has been a hoot. We'll be watching.
I'm not an expert in racism.
Not an expert in racism, that's what you said? Is that what you...
In what you just said, you said in work, you said expert 30 years of workplace racism research. I don't do that type of research.
Okay. 30 years of experience studying the workplace. Probably
yes.
Racism too, in my opinion, but yes. Much obliged for sharing some of your time and energy with us this Monday. We'll keep an eye on what's happening in your state tomorrow evening. And yes, indeedy. Thank you for your time, Dr. Sias.
All right. Thank you. All right. Bye-bye.
Context of white supremacy. White guests only. White guests only. I had somebody today who messaged me again, a non-white guest, and I cannot think of how many times I've had people who have written and suggested, hey, Brother Gus, I know that you said we're only having white guests on the program, but I found this here black person, and a number of these folks have either been married to white people or they have white parents, like white guests only. Reason, explanation, because I know it's not clear, and I'm sure for years I've said, literally for more than a decade I've said, I really prefer to have white guests on the program. Like, that's what the COWS was intended for, to talk to, question suspected racists. That's the whole point of this. Talk to Mr. Fuller about this. He wholeheartedly agreed. Right on, Gus. Yes, it should be. And he put a number on. He said, yeah, this was like 12 years ago, more than a dozen years. He said, it should be 2 to 1, at least, like 2 white guests for every 1 white guest, at least. Like, yeah, that's where the focus should be with all of this. I couldn't agree more. I think it should be even higher than 2 to 1. Why? Number one, the problem, Dr. Sias. Racist woman, racist man, racist child. That is number one. We can sit around and call Ice Cube names and Lil Wayne and Kanye West. Incidentally, anybody who is on my Facebook page, if you like to name call black people, please unfriend. I waste so much time having to go through. This election season has really pulled it out. Having to go through just looking on my page with an Ice Cube, no count coon, and a sellout. And they're coming on my page to do all this. Like, I probably wouldn't say anything or care if you were just doing it on your page. But to come on my page and coon and Sambo and no count Tom, like, really. Unfriend. Just unfriend. And then you can call. Again, pointing out, the 10 stops. I don't think no sex with white people. I don't think that's in the 10 stops. Not name calling other black people is. But the point of it, again, unfriend. If you got a name call of the black people, you got to let Ice Cube know he's a coon. Unfriend. But anyway, white guests only because I've concluded it just doesn't make a whole lot of sense to invest time. Now, we can get Ice Cube. We can get him on the program. But you know Calcoon. You talk to President. We could do that, I guess, and spend, you know, an hour, 5 weeks, really. And get the rest of them and call them names and interrogate. And haven't you read Neely Fuller Jr.? I just haven't really seen where that is. There's much of a payoff to doing that. Not saying that you can't do it or what have you. What I have seen, there's an absence, a void, studying and questioning white people with suspicion, really paying attention to what they say, evaluating with logic. Does this make sense? Even, am I talking to somebody who is white? That's a major one. Now, I knew we were going to be in for a performance. She, Dr. Sias, emailed me this. Let me read the email. We'll be here tomorrow while I'm switching. I'm going to have to log out and log into my other account, so it'll take a second. We'll be here tomorrow. I think 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, 7 p.m. Pacific. We'll be here for the election. We'll see what happens. Dr. Sias is in Arizona. Four more years. President Trump is taking the desert. But we'll be here. We'll see what happens tomorrow. Biden could be victorious. Maybe four more years. We'll see what happens. 10 p.m. Eastern, 9 p.m. Central, 7 p.m. Pacific, Tuesday. All right, so this morning, I knew we were going to be in for a hoot. So Dr. Sias emailed me. I look forward to our discussion tonight. I was listening to your broadcast from last week to prepare a little and appreciate you letting listeners know I'll be on the show tonight. I did want to mention one thing. I noticed that you referred to me as a white woman. Just to let you know, I'm actually half Mexican. My mother was first generation Mexican American. My dad was white. So I don't fully identify as white. It shouldn't make any difference to our discussion about workplace relationships, but I just wanted to give you a heads up. Now, particularly if you had heard the entire portion of the broadcast, just that alone, I know Gus T was super confused not that long ago, just that alone. I'd have been, oh, right on, we're talking to a brown sister, black and brown people, the people of color, right on. That would have been enough to, oh, okay, right on. As Dr. Sias said immediately and with a chuckle, Mexican is not a racial classification, just that alone. And paying attention, all those chuckles while we're discussing this. What's funny about that? Racial classifications are important. We just read that encased, white by law, nothing to chuckle about. People die over racial classifications. And then joking about being white, like, whoa, that makes you extra dangerous. We're going to have a discussion about anything, particularly racism, and you're joking, fooling around about white. Even I asked specifically, what's on your driver's license? Not going to horse around with you. White people don't horse around about all of that. Mark the form. The census comes around, mark the form. Now, they might give you the other box and all that, but I mean, hey, make it plain. Let me see that their driver's license. You go through TSA. They want a racial classification. Make it plain. Don't talk to me like you're playing ignorant. Racial classification? What is? I don't know. Lord, what is that? Racial class? I've never heard that before. Get out of here. Just getting practice with questioning white people. Attack? What do you mean attack? I've been accused. Oh. And then she offers a tacky apology once Rob points that out. All of that is important, being able to question white people. I would much rather question white people with suspicion. And she was tacky the whole way through. She started out with a racial classification, create confusion all the way through. People are like, what? Mexican? Little brown girl? Are you white? Wait a minute. All of that, and then we get to the end. So white people don't want black friends, right? Right. So how do we overcome that in the workplace? Oh, well, it's demographic dissimilarity. That's what it is. Buckets of words. Wait a minute. What happened to it just being white people practice racism? It's not about just being around people that are different from you. How different? White guests only. White guests only. I think it is important as well for victims of racism to hear that. I don't think most victims of racism in the known universe get to hear someone classified as white get questioned, even get questioned when they come out with that nonsense and confusion around their racial classification, to be questioned where a white person has to respond logically. All of that trumps calling Ice Cube and Lil Wayne a Sambo and a coon, and or having to listen to confused victims say that there is no racism, it's classism and all this. And I also want to tell you about my biracial family, who certainly is not racist. White guests only. White guests only. White guests only. Let's see. Folks who are with us, any comments that they would like to share, what they heard, Dr. Sias?
Yes, sir. Can I be heard?
We'll get, I heard you, retired firefighter. We'll get Silent Warrior, just because he didn't get to ask a question, although he was here. Do you have commentary you wanted to share? I think it's, let me give our time stamp. It's been a minute. 4:07 a.m. I think they switched the clocks and everything. I think it's 4:07 a.m. You can let us know. Silent Warrior, if you're there, is it 4:07?
Can you hear me?
Yes, sir.
Yes, it is 4:07. Yes, my counter racism pen pal told me that something hot was happening on cows, so I had to come on, and I made an observation. One of the guests asked, said that she was accusing you of something, of being aggressive towards her on something, and the question he asked was, why did you do that? And her response was to say, well, I shouldn't have done that, blah, blah, blah. But she didn't answer the question why she actually did it. She's a PhD. She does analysis of interactions between people. It would have been very helpful. It would be very revealing. It could be very helpful for us, and even for our own work, to just give an honest answer about, you know, why she did that. So I thought that was, I noticed that she didn't answer the question. So I just want to point that out. She might have tried to answer it later, saying she felt a bit defensive or whatever, but it would have been better for her to just say that. And her not saying that meant she wasn't being honest. And, you know, for me, this is the benefit of the cows, to hear some really constructive questions to people who classify themselves as white, and to it, a lot gets revealed. So I'm getting better at paying attention. So that's my comment. Thank you.
White guests only. White guests only. 4:09 a.m. in the morning, Tuesday, Austria time. Whew. Much obliged, Silent Warrior. Maybe we'll get an election pick from him, so we can add that to our group of folks who picked around the world. Much obliged for your patience, retired firefighter. And to Silent Warrior's point, it was the word attack. That was the question Rob asked, which was important. Why did you use the word attack, that no count nigra? Why did you say that Gus attacked you? And then she gave her tacky apology.
Very, very uncanny. It's so fluid. It's so fluid when you hear that's why I'm with you 100% on the guests being white, because they are experts. I mean, the words just flow, and the person doesn't really have to be a doctor in education working in a college, to be as fluid as she was in her technique to make a false accusation, and within seconds, avoided by using a flimsy apology of it. In other words, basically, in most cases, she wins with comments like that because non-white people are not experts on racism, white supremacy. And they it would just miss us as far as that word attack. And then, as I mentioned before, on how very similar she was to a white woman that I know she never met. Within seconds, you would have law enforcement in some cases, or you would have the head echelon of your employment coming to your work site, you know, that sort of thing, and basically threatening you. And I had one more question I wanted to ask her, and that is, well, who is the opponent of white women? You know, who is actually the opponent of white women on this earth? You know, and you know, just listen to what she would say as an answer. You know, with the advent of white women, quote unquote, working towards a better workplace for themselves and invest. Well, who is the opponent? Who is the opponent to that? Is it black males? I mean, don't help her with the answer. That's it. I was just thinking about those things, you know, the word attack and then, you know, all this thing about, you know, white women. Oh, yeah, well, one more thing. The whole idea, there was another period of time when she mentioned that she is half white and half Mexican. That was the third time somebody asked her for the third time on what is her racial classification, and she said something towards half Mexican and half white. What the hell is that? You know, I mean, very fluid and skilled. Those are my comments. Thank you.
Much obliged, retired firefighter. The opponents of white women are other white women, frequently. Formidable foe. Hillary Clinton was defeated in 2016, and all or 52% of white women voters supported our current president. So, yes, the opponent of white women is white women. Other folks... any other folks have comments, thoughts, observations they wanted to share?
No, we heard.
Rob in California.
Yes, thank you. My observation about the guest, her responses was very immediate and very short. I noticed that when people were talking, she was like, like not really even, you know, taking in what that person was saying. And I, from listening to the program, I know to ask people, or I'm aware of the racial classifications of, a Hispanic white and a non-Hispanic white. So when I asked her what her classification, that Hispanic white, she flatly answered it. And, you know, man, because, and this is what was very confusing for me. Like, so I'm listening to the program, like, okay, I got cut off a few times, and then I'm calling back in. And then when you were laying out your definition of racism and, you know, asking her a racial classification, and she was like, I'm half Mexican, And then I got cut off again. So I didn't know if she ever, like, answered the question. And I want to say it was the caller in Dallas, or another caller asked her her racial classification, and she was elusive again. And but she was alluding to her racial classification being white. And then when you asked her your famous question about, are, you know, white people greatly pained behind racism, she, like, the answer to her, the answer to that question was her being referred to as a brown person. And then, like, at that point, I was really confused. Right? And I'm like, well, what's going on right now? And then I'm like, oh, okay, she's a Hispanic white person. And then, because when I'm listening to her talk, I can hear that she's not, quote unquote, white or classified as white. But at the same time, she is classified as white. And what I wanted to ask her, I wanted to ask her a couple of more questions. I wanted to ask her, did white people accept her as white? But she answered that question when she said, she was referred to as a brown person. So obviously they don't accept her as, quote unquote, a white person. So she's a Hispanic white. And then I wanted to ask her, did she have offspring? And then I wanted to ask her, what color is her offspring? And then how did she talk to her offspring about how to, depending on what color they were classified as, how does she talk to them about moving in the workplace? And thank you for taking the call.
Much obliged, Rob in California. The phone, lots of phone disruptions. Lots, like I said, myself included, lots of folks have labored through that recently, especially. So usual suspects. Thank you for your patience, though, Rob. The racial classification component, that alone is like worthy of a sound clip, just that first like 10 minutes or so. Eventually, after all of Hispanic white and half white and white parent, Mexican is not a racial classification, which she knew immediately and chuckled, she said Hispanic white. And I said, so is it accurate to say that you are a white woman? And she said, yes. And it took all of that to do. So from that point, once I said, it's accurate to say you're a white woman. Yes. Bing. Okay. Just white woman. That's the way we're sparking the rest of it. But I do think she can skillfully use that to cause confusion. If she wants to allay suspicion, as, oh, I'm Mexican and I'm half white and they thought of me as a little brown person. White people do squabble amongst themselves. That's in case to a very minimal degree, but they do squabble amongst themselves about white and calling folks meds and Southern Italians and all the rest of that. You're classified as white. You're classified as white. Got it. But I mean, that's just causing confusion with racial classifications. Mr. Fuller has in the word guide, half white should not be used. That is not a classification. Mexican isn't a racial classification, period. But when he has about so-called half white, do not use this term. Do not use terms that are similar to this term. Do not use terms like part white, dark white, off white, part Indian, part Mexican, part colored, mulatto, etc. As long as white supremacy exists, practice limiting all classifications of people in regards to color to three: white, non-white, and white supremacists. Use the term non-white to include any persons who are not white and not classified as white. Just to the other point, I do not know that other white people do not accept her as white. That was why I asked, what's on your driver's license? What is on your birth certificate? That would show me a lot more. But the fact that she's even saying white Hispanic, you would at minimum, at least for me, and this is VGQ for everybody, at minimum, you would be a suspected race soldier. And like I said, eventually, after all the buckets of words, is it accurate to say that you're a white woman, Dr. Sias? Yes. Proceed. But that's VGQ, and that's, again, why it is important, I think, to talk to folks classified as white. Racial classifications alone cause a lot of confusion, and white people, in my view, deliberately use those racial classifications to cause confusion. Hope that was logical, made sense. If it didn't, speak up. Other folks, any other comments, questions, observations?
Can I be heard?
Mo in Dallas.
I'll wait. Go ahead.
Oh, did B in Toronto? Were you there?
It's okay. I'll yield to Mo in Dallas. Thank you.
Thank you, ma'am. Well, I apologize for her accusing you of attacking her. That was interesting in itself. I also found it very interesting that you did not know what was on her birth certificate. And I just wanted to, I had an additional question I would like to ask, and I want to put it out. So she does have a PhD in communication and educate. She trains people. I would have liked to know if she learned anything during this call. That would have been my last question. But maybe next time. But that's all I had. Leave my life.
Learn not to talk to those Negroes. Not sure. Be in Toronto.
Yes, thank you. From the time that she was explaining her racial classification, I started timing it. And I would say it took approximately an hour and 15 minutes. And it got the part that I recognized that she finally identified herself as white was when you got to the greatly pained question. And as soon as she said we, to me, that was an indication that she identified herself as white, without the Hispanic, without all these other combinations. And it really got me to thinking as to how effectively these terms such as people of color and I'm half this, half that, has really infiltrated and thoroughly confused victims of white supremacy, primarily non-white black people. So, that was just an observation. The other observation that I noticed is how she was slightly altering my questions, my original questions to her, which was also, I found, was very interesting. Thank you, and I leave the line.
Words are important. They will just change just a term here and there, and a lot of times that can make a huge difference to, you know, what we're attempting to get at. So, yes, words are very important. And yes, we white people, even the birth certificate, driver's license, like, really? You don't know what's on those important legal documents. Gotcha. Did any other folks comments, observations?
I also think that we need to challenge white people more when they answer that question and saying that white people are more confused about the system of race of white supremacy. That needs to be challenged more by a white person that states that, because it's just completely illogical in itself, and they're not challenged enough for making that statement, for answering that statement in that way, in my understandings of things. And what does anybody else think about that?
I agree. She seemed that white people were more confused, you know, right off the bat. Like, we are, yes. Like, it was just very enthusiastic. And she was very confident that white people were more confused. So
I agree with retired firefighter.
But they hardly ever give a reason or an explanation. They hardly ever give an explanation on it, other than as what she said, is that because they don't have the problem. Well, just because they don't have the problem, that don't mean that they don't know more. That's probably why they are not victims of racism, because they're knowledgeable. They're more knowledgeable on it. Go ahead. I'm gonna shut up. Go ahead. Anybody else?
I agree, because if I had car troubles, I could be confused to why my car wasn't working. If I took my car to a mechanic, like, he would be less confused, even less confused than I am. So I don't know if that's appropriate analysis, but it seemed to fit.
May I add?
Yes, ma'am. Go ahead. Please.
Thanks. I think that there is a number of times that she actually unveiled herself, so to speak, in that she recognized that she was the problem. Just the way in some of the how she answered her questions, when she was, even though she used confusion, she used a lot of tactics to try and undermine the discussion. But there are times that she had unveiled herself, that she's recognized that she's part of the problem. And I think that's really part of the reason as to why she said that she was feeling attacked. And when she used the word attack, that for some reason, Birth of a Nation popped into my mind. Like it's just typical white woman. But thanks, I leave the line.
May I speak?
Yes, sir.
Silent warrior.
This feeling about being attacked could also be feeling guilty or being extremely uncomfortable about being exposed as a racist to a group of non-white people. For some reason, I've observed that white people don't want to be called racist. Like, they don't want to... I'm confused about why they feel like that's such a... Well, I can understand they don't want to be called racist because it destroys the myth of white superiority and white moral superiority. So if you're racist, then you can't be morally supreme, or you can't be a better person than everyone else. Okay. But this I think the question you raised, retired firefighter, about who's more confused, I think that's a really good question to ask. It's very... it reveals a lot. And I had joined this Facebook group called Whiteness, an anti-racism learning group created by white women. And it has a portion of non-white people in there. And I ran a poll in there, and I said, which group is more confused about racism, white people or non-white people? 108 votes were for non-white people, were for white people by the people in this group. And this is white people, white women, white men, non-white men, non-white women. Almost all of them in this group. Everyone in this group said that white people were the ones that were more confused. And the only people that said that non-white people were the most confused was myself and my counter-racism pen pal. Was also joined the group. And here's one statement by a white person. She says, "I don't think you can be confused about something you have experience with." So that's just like what retired firefighter said. She continues to say that the only people confused are the ones who have the privilege to have no personal experience. So that statement tells me that if they're having a model of racism, that you can only know about racism if you have experienced it. And they use the word privilege because white people who have privilege are not experiencing racism. But it's like there's nobody actually practices in racism in that model. So that's why they don't, that's the, seems to be the thinking in their mind why they think that white people are more confused. So instead of people being racist, they're confused. And that, of course, leads to the thinking that people are ignorant. That goes further to lead to the thinking that non-white people should, as they ask in this group, they ask non-white people to tell them about racism and how to be better and things like that. But I keep, my analysis is that this is the way for them to refine the practice. They never, no one gets around to putting your finger on the person that the group of people actually practices in racism. And instead, you're just, they turn non-white people into a feedback system to help white people refine their own practice, which is what I think is happening big time with these protests. She just to finish her comment, she says, yeah, some more buckets of words. She talks about even conservative people of color who support Trump will not deny they've received comments at some point in their lives based on their skin color or ethnicity. They just conceptualize it as an individual problem instead of a societal or systemic one, I think. So she's saying that conservative, non-white people who are supporting Trump experience racism, but they just think it was a one-off problem. And then, yeah. So, I think, I mean, that's one of the quickest ways, I think, other than the question about are you a white person or not, and seeing how they dip in and out of that, I think that this question about who is more confused about racism is a really good litmus test. And that's all I have to say. Thank you.
And this other statement she used twice by talking about something called ally, which in my opinion, the assumption is we're talking about white people helping non-white people. They're ridiculous.
Yeah.
All of those times that I sat into an office, it wasn't no white person kicking the door down and saying, hey, a retired firefighter is being mistreated by you racist white person. I never heard nothing like that. I mean, get out of here.
It seems
ally.
It seems like when they say ally, it's, I'm going to, you've just been attacked by racism and you're suffering, and now I'm going to pet you and give you an example of a white person who isn't going to talk to you or treat you in a way that this other white person treated you. And I will be able to maintain the myth in your mind about white people are good and those racist white people are ignorant. But then at the same time, hide the fact that I'm supporting racism by confusing you even further. It's a very sophisticated approach by these allies. And then if you,
I mean, I studied World War II, and in World War II you had white people who were allies killing other white people, literally killing other white people, because they were allies to that other group of white people. You know, I mean, come on. You know, so that's why I asked her, are they willing to lose their lives in the process? You know, I mean, hell no.
That was nowhere close to it. thought that was an excellent question. I mean, if they're so willing to quote Martin Luther King, are they willing to, as an ally, also make that sacrifice?
There wasn't a white person standing near him on that balcony. Nowhere around when he got his face shot off. That should be the last word comes out of their mouths. Sorry for sounding a little bit excited, but
no, but it's. I think it's good observations that clarified. You know, when I looked at the picture of Dr. Patricia Sias, and I thought, yeah, I could get confused by this. It looks like someone with a tan, but you could tell by the, I mean, as soon as I came on the broadcast and I heard the tone in her voice, and she's sounding skeptic of even being on the show, and then I hear some recollection of how she's been responding to the questions and so on. I can tell this is someone who's been socialized as a white person. This is someone who believes that they're white. And the giggling.
Yeah.
She said that she had been listening to
that's always show. That's always a sign.
Yes, sir. When she sends in the email to Gus today that she had been listening to his previous shows.
Probably listening right now.
Yeah. But when she says she's been listening to the previous shows, that just tells me that she's telling Gus, like, I know what you're about. I ain't going to get caught. Or you've got some way of thinking about racism that I'm going to let you know I'm prepared for, so don't try to get up today. I think it's
sounds
more
correct, Gus?
Yeah, does that sound correct, Gus?
I generally feel like the white people who listen to the program will be, that's why it'll take 20 minutes for them to identify as white. Like, they will be much more cautious about what they say, and or they will engage in a lot more deception. Like I said, us taking, B said it, we spent an hour and 15 minutes on the racial classification. Like, oh, they're less confused. I'm not even white. Like, before we even get here, like, yep, I've been listening and I'm not a white person. Like, that's been my experience generally with white people who listen to the program in advance. Much more difficult to get accurate information from them.
She sounded prepared.
Be in Toronto.
Sorry. Yes, I just had another thing that I had noticed in terms of a tactic just to be aware of. I just thought of this right now because a similar situation had happened to me at many plantations ago at a group home where there was a training, and I was inquiring with the trainer, who happened to be one of the employees, about their credentials and how they were running the training program. This particular training was to assist workers in being safe in very unpredictable and possibly dangerous situations, like having to disarm themselves or disarm a weapon from a client. And this trainer, who was a white woman, was doing such a horrible job in the training. And I remember it was myself and another black woman who were questioning the credentials of this trainer and the way that she was training. And I remembered, as I continued pressing the question, she turned to the other black female and said, that was a great question. You're very smart. And I noticed that the black female shut down, like she just knew that validation would shut down one person and keep them from asking the hard question. And I noticed this tactic came up today or tonight, where she had mentioned two occasions that I was very smart. And I don't know if that was her tactic to try and shut me down and try to seemingly create an alliance, but I'm aware of that strategy, and I didn't back down. So it's just something that I just wanted to point out. White people tend to use that strategy many times. As soon as they give validation to a Black person, if they're not aware of it, they will shut down and be pacified. So just to keep that in mind. And maybe others may have observed that in their own lives as well.
Yes, sir. Rob in California.
Oh, just very quickly, excellent observation being Toronto. I did observe her point out that you were smart. And when she pointed that out, I was so confused, like I didn't understand it, but I peeped it, quote unquote. Like, and so when I observed it, I was like, I was like, is she like being condescending right now? Like, what is she doing? Why did she point that out? The immediate thought that I had was, how are you qualified to like just determine that somebody is smart or, you know, intelligent or whatever? Thank you.
She's white. Definitely be my, I say really be mindful of the compliments from anybody, but in a system of white supremacy, but definitely race soldiers. And I say often that can happen in a workplace capacity too, but any context where they can kind of get us to not be suspicious of them, like, oh wow, got some white validation, this is one of the good ones, don't be fooled. Had some folks in the workplace situation where it would be a white person to come and compliment you about your wardrobe, and they're the same ones who are talking bad about you like seconds later. Very, very common. Any other final thoughts before we wrap up? Again, here tomorrow, U.S. presidential election.
Anybody still here?
For sure, if everybody's all satisfied, we will wrap up and pick up for Tuesday evening, 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific. Be done. Well, hopefully we can be done with all the election nonsense. Hopefully this won't be something that drags on for days and, you know, we get to the weekend and still don't know. Hopefully it's 2020 with all the newfangled technology. We can have all this done, move forward, figure out, you know, who'll be sitting at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue sometime late January 2021. But that'll be tomorrow. I would again hunker down if you can. If you do not have to be outside, stay in. Try to get, you know, hopefully you got groceries, any other necessities over the weekend early today so that you don't have to go out now that it's dark and late. But try to stay in the house, especially if you have offspring or anything. Just hunker down. You know, you can watch TV, get on the Zoom, whatever else, and no need to take any chances on what's going to happen, regardless of who is victorious tomorrow. Just watch it scroll by on your timeline, and then once it's all right, we're back to conditions where I feel like I can go outside and not have a brick thrown through my windshield or be accosted, and go back to somewhat normal Rona procedures. But stay safe, hunker down for tomorrow. And yeah, you'll have listening options. We'll be here 10 p.m. Eastern, 7 p.m. Pacific. We'll be here to see what happens. Much obliged for the folks who listened in. Hope it was worthy of your Monday evening. White guests only. We should have a white man here next week. White guests only as we go through the end of 2020. Everybody's good? No, we didn't miss anybody?
I'll be here tomorrow. Thank you very much, boss.
Much obliged.
A lot of politics was instructive.
Didn't mean to interrupt you. Sorry about that. Guess he's good. Yes. We will look out for you tomorrow. Silent Warrior, I guess it'll be morning. He won't have to be up late by the time we'll be on late enough that, yeah, it'll be sun hopefully will be getting ready to come up maybe. And, yeah, he can be enjoying his Wednesday. It'll be Tuesday for us, Tuesday evening. But for Silent Warrior, his Wednesday morning, we see what happens with the election. Again, much obliged for everyone listening in. White guests only. Thanks for the folks who fought through the phone issues. I've hated that. It's been so consistent this calendar year with the craziness with the phone and everything, really. But the archive should be fine for folks who had difficulties. And yeah, Apple Podcasts, Black Talk Radio Network, Blueberry, SoundCloud, Google Play. Lots of platforms for you to access the content. Let me know if you have trouble with the archives. With that, sobriety would be best under conditions of white supremacy. We will need our brain computer working at a highly efficient level to thwart the likes of Dr. Sias. In addition to being sober, let's be buckled every time we are in a vehicle, driver or passenger. Again, hunker down. It's not really the time to be out and about. You can wait a few days, right? Hopefully, we don't need to go out to get too many supplies. Hopefully, we have enough items in the residence to take care of you and your household for, you know, 4 or 5 days, just to make sure that things are calm here in the States, that you can get back out safely, relatively so, given the Rona. But yeah, definitely the next 2 days, I would be in the house. Get some cooking going, read, lots to watch on TV, as I said. Just no need to take unnecessary risks this calendar year. If you do go out, again, certainly no altercations, no arguing, verbal jousting with strangers. Assume everybody is armed. Anything looks like they're turning up a little bit, out of here. This whole little excursion is done. No risk taking this week. All about maximizing safety for the next few days. So we are sober, hunkering down. If you gotta go out, you are buckled, driver or passenger. If you are driving, you are not on the cell phone. One, we got to be maximally alert, just paying attention to what's happening around us. Make sure we're safe as can be. And trying to minimize contact with race soldiers, badge or no, just doing the small things to try to stay safe under conditions of white terrorism. All of that said, Creator, we ask that you help us remain patient with other black people, victims of white supremacy. We ask that you help us remain patient with ourselves. Remind us to demonstrate the highest levels of black self-respect at all times, in all places, each and every time we are in contact with another black person. No name calling. Cows signing out. Thanks all for tuning in.